I'm not going to speak for too long. I'm going to do a short presentation. I'm sure most of you know something about Brexit, but perhaps you know less about its implications. And I've talked much during my visiting scholar tenure over the last few months about the impact on the European Union, about the impact on Anglo-American relationships of Brexit. And I've talked an awful lot about the degree of uncertainty that is really quite pervasive amongst thought leaders, diplomats, politicians, and in the business community. But nonetheless, with such uncertainty, with so much that cannot be known, there are, I think, some things that we can know, drawing upon two areas. One, lessons from history and understanding British political history, and another, understanding the British mind. It's not very fashionable in this day and age to talk about minds and characteristics, but there is a very rich academic literature about understanding political culture, and if you will, a British and an English mind. And I think that's quite instructive when one tries to put and apply that to the issue of Britain's withdrawal from the EU. Now, I'm a pretty 20th century kind of guy in a 21st century kind of world, so I will try. I want to show you this, and I'm praying it will work because it'll just give a flavour.
That's all from me for now. Back to you, Andrew.
Many thanks, Louise. Now, as I said, this is a very different kind of Sunday morning, and if you'll forgive me, I just wanted to start with a few thoughts of my own, because this is the most dramatic and important democratic decision ever taken by the British people. But it leaves our country deeply divided. It's not just the overall numbers, the 17 million leavers against the 16 million stayers. The minute you dig down at all into the data, you find that poorer areas with more unskilled and semi-skilled workers and more pensioners were much likelier to vote leave. The map of the results shows a yawning gap between the posher, better educated and richer parts of Britain, London, some of the city centres elsewhere, university towns and so on, and the huge swathes of post-industrial, ex-mining and struggling fishing and agricultural Britain. Whatever the politicians tell us, right at the moment, we are not one country. Now, none of this should come as a surprise, nor can we really blame today's campaigners. For the past 50 years, we have seen a decline in heavy industrial, making things, exporting Britain, and the rise in service industries, banking and culture, which mopped up some of the lost jobs. Under our last five prime ministers, we became a shopping nation. London boomed as a global centre, while, ignored by too much of the political and media class, places like industrial Wales, the Black Country, and struggling coastal towns became ever poorer, ever more desolate. Meanwhile, waves of migration and globalised culture washed among us, eroding our sense of self. Whole communities changed colour and language, leaving older people bemused and cut off. As the numbers from Eastern Europe rose, eager, white, hard-working, new neighbours, alarm grew in the poorer parts of the country. But the self-confidently multi-ethnic, liberal, urban class, high on high house prices and high employment levels, was having such a good time they barely noticed. London spoke a lot, but didn't listen. Well, it's heard now. This has been the rebellion of the diminished against the cocky, the ignored against the shapers of modern times, and the struggling against the strutting.
Why is that instructive? That's instructive because this is Andrew Marr. For those of you who don't know Andrew Marr, he was for a decade BBC's political editor. So BBC One's political editor. Numero uno. The most important broadcast journalist in the United Kingdom. Since then, for the last 10 years after that, he is the presenter and interviewer par excellence of the Sunday morning political show. Our country is still small enough that we watch quite a lot of the same TV. That's changing with Netflix, it's changing with a whole range of other things. He is at the top of the liberal establishment. He is not a Daily Mail or a Daily Express journalist. He is not on the right. He's not a reactionary. This is a doyen, an exemplar of the British, because he's a Scot, and educated at Cambridge, he's a British establishment. And that was his. And he said, my own personal remarks. Little disclaimer, he wasn't speaking for Auntie. Auntie is a colloquial term for the BBC. He was speaking for Mr. A. Marr, Esquire. Now, I think that's, when he thinks that, we know we have a revolution on our hands. What is Brexit? Ladies and gentlemen, you're a learned audience. You know that it means the United Kingdom's withdrawal from the EU. You probably also have realised that it is, without doubt, an existential crisis for the European Union. But it's also the beginning. It's the birthing. More than the birth pangs, more than the labour pains, it's the birthing of a new political and economic era of uncertainty. Now, uncertainty isn't necessarily a bad thing, but it breeds all sorts of anxiety, which necessarily is a bad thing. With markets, with investment for business, with people who have one level of citizenship and they find themselves resident in another country, about how one plans for one's life, one's family's life, what one does with one's education, with one's assets. Highly, highly unstable, uncertain era. The result, and I think this is just, I've just put it up just to give you a sense. I don't want to bombard you with statistics. But this is an immensely high turnout. As a political scientist, yeah, you'd love 100% of adults who could vote to vote, but really, you know, dreamland would be 80% in the United Kingdom. Anything over 70 is overwhelming. I mean, in the recent past, it's overwhelming. But the margin of victory is immensely narrow. The margin is immensely narrow. People hold as strong views on the Leave side as they do on the Remain side. There have been studies done, there have been documentaries on BBC Radio 4, a little like with the Scottish independence referendum of 2014, showing how families are divided on this issue. Spouses are divided on this issue. Brothers and sisters, let alone neighbours and co-workers, are divided on this issue. People who share a territory, a common language, they may share what they do for a living. They may, you know, be similarly educated or do something similar for their occupation. They are divided on this issue. But you can, as Marr said, as I'm sure we're all aware, you can generalise. And you can look at the richer, more educated, more metropolitan type of voter versus less educated. Voters tend to be older, over the age of 40, and they tend to be outside of the metropolis, so outside of London and the very large British cities. That's most people, actually, because most people in the United Kingdom live in the urban areas, but not all cities are pro-EU. The metropolis, that's the point I make. I make a distinction, I'll come to it, between cosmopolitans and small-c conservatives. These conservatives can appear and do appear on the centre-left and on the centre-right. It's not capital C conservatives. These are cosmopolitans versus small-c conservatives. I don't know, my Californian culture and politics is not good, but I imagine it's maybe your Bay Area versus maybe your Central Valley. Maybe. I don't know. That might be too basic a dichotomy. But it's I think this is cosmopolitans versus conservatives. What's the short answer, Matt? Give us the headline. And why did it happen? Why did Britain choose to vote to leave in 2016? What's the short answer? I think the short answer, and I think the polling data certainly supports this, the impact of mass, low-skill and no-skill EU immigration. That was the key factor. That's why people who don't usually vote in general elections, where you choose the government, you choose Her Majesty's government for 5 years within the United Kingdom, have decided to vote. Enough people, a sufficient number, have said through polling that the main issue for them was the mass EU, not international immigration, just EU immigration, of low-skill and no-skill workers. This is a study from Oxford University, pretty left-wing organisation, I'd say. I always, when I try and make the point, I always try and use the strongest data and the strongest argument from perhaps the organisation or the individual who you might not think is going to come from. So it's their Migration Observatory, which is a study centre at the University of Oxford. So since 2001, Britain's had 3 million EU nationals come to live and work within it. And by the first quarter of 2015, these dates are always somewhat out of date with the data because it requires a period of time to count and to verify. 3 million EU nationals and 1.9 million of them working. Why only 1.9 million? Well, some of them now have children, some of them have adolescents who are in education, but some of them aren't working as well, obviously. So this is the data, the short-term argument, why a sufficient number of people decided that in 2016, membership of the EU is no longer in Britain's interest. Not that everything the EU has ever done, not every initiative that Britain has been involved with in the EU, but at that moment in time, because of this relatively new phenomena of mass low-skill and no-skill migration, which has to be said is from former Soviet states, men and women, but vast majority of men, relatively few women, young men, fit, strong men, 40 years and under. Well, how do you know all this? Because Her Majesty's government issues people with national insurance cards, which is where you get your national insurance number, without which you cannot work. And on that, there is data of where one has come from, so one's nationality within the EU, how old one is, what is one's gender, etc., etc., etc. So this is what we know. These are young, fit, strong men from Eastern and Southeastern Europe whose families have lived for 70 years under the tyranny of Marxist-Leninism. Of course they want to come to the United Kingdom and especially to Germany. Of course they want to come to these two countries. Well, why not other countries? Well, it's kind of easy to come to the United Kingdom because most other people, if they know a smattering of another language, they know English, and the English, like myself, are dreadful monoglots. And so they'll come. Also, we do have, although we moan about it a great deal, and coming to this country has actually made me value public health even more, I must admit, we have a socialised medicine, a public medicine. You're not going to die on the streets of England. If you need to have your legs set, or if you need to get meds, if you have an asthma attack, you know, the chances are you're going to get blue-lighted in an ambulance and taken to a hospital. In other words, that's a huge factor when one's considering the massive decision of leaving one's family in one's country and moving to another country. Also, the British government did not set specific controls, transition controls, unlike Germany and other large EU countries, for the last wave of accession countries to the EU. It felt that not many would come, it felt that it would be absolutely fine in terms of managing them, and we needed them, because, as Andrew Marr said, the economy was booming, although in my view, private debt was booming. The British are addicted to credit cards, and we have a religion these days. It's not Christianity, it's Marks and Spencers. and we shop at the high altar of the high street, and we spend that which we don't have on stuff, that which we don't need, to keep other people employed. So you could argue in a good old-fashioned Keynesian way that it's the consumption function of the economy. But people live beyond their means, they get mortgages beyond their means, not unlike the large cities in America, I think, as well. This is an Anglo-American capitalist problem. We need a more sensible, in my view, a more kind of German view of capitalism. Anyway, that's a different issue. Can't go into it much today. But that is why. That's the short answer, ladies and gents. The long-range factors. A resurgent Euroscepticism in the Conservative Party, especially when it was in coalition government with the most Europhile, federalist, almost, Liberal Democrats between 2010 and 2015. That connected to the fact that an awful lot of Tories did not think their leader and the Prime Minister of the day, the Conservative Prime Minister David Cameron, was sufficiently or really a Conservative. They felt he was a Conservative in name only. I think they're right, actually. I've actually written an essay about this. I think he really is a Liberal rather than a Conservative. He's constitutionally Conservative, but on every other marker, social issues, economic issues, he's a Liberal. So he was Eurosceptic in the sense that he thought, the EU's not perfect and Britain can get a better deal. A lot of people think that. But he wasn't Eurosceptic in the way that you have to be a Eurosceptic to really walk in step with the Conservative Party. To really be a modern Conservative. Ever since the last days of Mrs. Thatcher's tenure, you need to be a believer in free market economics, you need to be a Eurosceptic, and you must be an Atlanticist. You must be an Atlanticist. He wasn't viewed as sufficiently conservative, and when you add that to the rise, the rather surprising rise, of the United Kingdom Independence Party under the leadership of Nigel Farage, with his great gift of speaking in a politically incorrect way, in a plain English way, and portraying himself, though he was a city trader by profession, and not exactly someone from the lower orders, as the man in the pub, you know, that has been tremendous, and willing to speak truth to power, and say some things that the BBC wouldn't say, and that even Sky News wouldn't say, owned by Rupert Murdoch, they wouldn't say these things. Yet we were all saying these things. And this leads me to a point which I'm going to come back on about freedom of speech. And what I do think, partly this problem is a wider problem. There is a real issue in Britain and in Canada and in the United States, and especially on university campuses, which is the illiberalism of contemporary liberalism. Universities were once the citadels of scientific inquiry and classical liberalism. Freedom of religion, speech, expression, assembly. And men and women would come, and they were bright, and they got into these institutions to read books, actual books. They read books. And they'd read the great thinkers of the past, the great poets and philosophers, and they'd argue. And nothing was off the table. Palpably, friends, that is not the case in institutions of higher education today. You all know it. You all know it. And I have been here when even protests from people I might find objectionable have been stopped through violence and bully boy tactics. That's not what a liberal society does. I'm sorry, call it what you want, but don't call it liberalism. It's not liberalism. And the great traditions of the 1960s, the speech movement of this campus, on that day, they fell asleep, or at worst, temporarily died. It is that kind of spirit of not wanting to say that there's a problem with mass immigration from the EU, and it's not racist to say so, especially when people have come are white men like me. This is not the same issue you have with California migrant workers. These are white men who've worked hard, coming to do jobs that most Brits don't want to do, and they're cock-a-hoop to do it for the British minimum wage, because it's three times what they pay in Krakow, or in Bucharest, or in Budapest. But you have to be able, in a mature democracy, in a liberal society, to have these free and honest discussions. The absence of that, especially by the Labour Party, has alienated Labour voters, which is part of the crisis for the Labour Party. So what did he do? Given these long-range factors, Cameron sought to stop the rot, to get a hold of the situation. He sought a renegotiation. He said there would be a poll, a referendum on this by the end of 2017. It occurred on the 23rd of June last year. Critics said he should never have given the poll. One, because such a poll should not be used for constitutional issues. Others said they're the sort of issues it should be used for. And other people have said by doing that, you allow the vox populi to speak into matters on which they're not educated. That absolutely spoke into this liberal elitist view, as opposed to the more democratic egalitarian view that we're citizens and we should be part of a national conversation. My personal view, I think they are pertinent, but they are more parochial. I think these are more international. I think what has also arisen simultaneously is the failure of a hyper-globalisation kind of approach. That globalisation necessarily leads to winners. It leads to winners and it leads to huge losers. Even huge losers in very rich, advanced capitalist countries. Also, I think the EU has two concomitantly related failures. One is the goal of widening of the EU, almost a little bit like America's manifest destiny, the manifest destiny to ever widening of the EU. I don't think this would have happened if we still had an EU of 18. But an EU of 28, it was perhaps on the cards. So I think widening to make it almost unsustainable, and let alone the EU, the euro crisis, for those EU member states who are in the single currency, and most of us in the United Kingdom have always been sceptical of single currency, just from the point that you have one central bank and one set of interest rates for many, many, many different countries at different stages of the business cycle. Some have more or less a share of their economy in services. Some have a greater or a lesser share of their jobs within manufacture. It's not surprising that we still have, well, Valentini would know what, 15% unemployment in Italy?
Yeah, it's pretty high.
Yeah, 20% in Portugal, 25% in Spain. This is not a Europe of two halves. This is Europe of two speeds, some going deeper into a more federal project, some staying on not quite the periphery, but wanting one foot in to federalism and one foot in self-determination. And as the academic Stephen George quite correctly labelled the United Kingdom, it was always the awkward partner. Now I want to say something, a little word of defence to my countrymen here. Yes, we were and still are the awkward partner. But I will say something. That which Conservative and Labour Prime Ministers have signed up to, generally, over the years, we pretty much complied with. We have other cousins within the EU who sign up to everything, but who have a kind of a Woolworths counter pick-and-mix approach to what they actually go along with. And I think that's, that, you know, that was important. So why 2016? The re-emergence on the backbenches of a sharp Euroscepticism, the rise of UKIP, Cameron being viewed as a liberal, and the impact, especially since 04 and 07, of low-skill and no-skill migration. And that has, when the opportunity came to have a referendum, those who don't usually vote, those who have been turned off by party politics, came and put their cross in the box. I'll finish with this. The long-term aftershocks, I think, for British politics are harder to see, but political history can show us, point us in the direction like a signpost, maybe some of the issues. One, I think, is the uncertainty principle. We don't know to what extent Britain is going to flourish or flounder outside of the single market. A lot will come down to trade deals. Trade deals are notoriously long to agree. They are highly politically and market sensitive. And really, that, I guess, was what the vast majority of the main parties were hoping when they said, we'll be poorer if we leave the EU. I think that's true. We will be poorer if we leave the EU. That's true. Certainly until good trade deals are made, I think we are be poorer. But here's the thing. It's about the net benefit. What does the net benefit look like? If a senior politician says to you, what does the net benefit mean to you and your family? I don't know what a net benefit feels like. I understand it at an abstract level. I know what a lived experience feels like. I know if the school my son is in is majority Polish speaking rather than English speaking. I know if my daughter can't get on the housing ladder because we don't build council houses, municipal houses anymore in England, hardly at all. And we've had this raft of houses of multiple occupation being bought up by private developers to put three Lithuanians, three Poles, three Bulgarians in a room, 15 men in a house. I know that. I know if the high street that someone walks down has been, you know, there's just supermarket after supermarket after supermarket selling certain goods from certain countries. Where are the local retailers or little shops, independent traders used to be? Now, in and of themselves, none of those are bad things. But when you aggregate them in the poorest communities, they become a substantial thing. That's a lived experience. The net benefit is not the lived experience. Oh, we'll be 2% poorer. Well, that's 3% taken off GDP. Okay, well, if you don't have much, that ain't going to be much for you. Are you surprised that only people who have something decided that that was a winning argument, as opposed to those who don't have much? And that leads me to Labour's loss. This is the mother of all headaches for the Labour Party. Historically, the Eurosceptic Party. By the early 90s, the pro-European Party. This is a headache for the progressives. Partly because, not because they have the most left-wing leader in their history. He is just a recent occurrence. It's not to do with Corbyn. Because irony, the real hard left of the Labour Party always felt that a common market was a capitalist club and they didn't want to be in it. You can YouTube Tony Benn, Corbyn's mentor, and to see him rail against the common market. It's not about that. It's not about the hard left. It's not about Corbyn. It's about the progressives being truly progressive. Labour has lost its sense of a British Labour tradition, a small-c conservative, patriotic, kind of pro-welfare state, pro-NHS, pro-police, strong navy kind of spirit. And it has become more metropolitan, and it's focused on gay rights, and human rights, and feminism, and abortion, and the European Union. Again, for a progressive, they're all great things. You support those rights. But it has diminished the piece of political real estate. It has diminished your share of the market you're selling to, because they were once fringe issues in that sense. Human rights, fringe issues, well, not in the sense that Britain had been a respecter of human rights for decades and decades, but notions of human rights being appealed to by European Court of Justice or a non-EU institution, the European Court of Human Rights. This rights agenda that has been divorced from a responsibilities agenda, which is very English actually, and communitarian, on the left, has pushed the narrative and the priorities of the Labour Party in a very clearly European progressive direction. Now, progressives might think, yeah, that's brutal, and that's fine, super. But you're going to have a hard time at elections. Because really, what you're saying is, we don't share your values, but we want your votes. This is where there are some commonalities with white, blue-collar, Midwest voters, not just men, but mainly men, but also female voters, who have voted Obama in 08, Obama 12, and gone from the most left-wing president you've probably had, some may say that was Johnson or Roosevelt, but in social ethics, I think certainly Obama, people who voted Obama, Obama, to Trump. It doesn't perfectly fit, but there are commonalities. The values gap is what I've just summed it up as. This is cosmopolitans versus conservatives. These are people who say, well, I've always voted Labour, I feel Labour, I'm not for free markets, I'm not for huge corporations running out the town, but yeah, I have a more traditional view of marriage, or I have a more traditional view of patriotism, and I think Britain is broadly a force for good in the world, and no, I don't think managed immigration from the EU is a bad thing, and I certainly don't think it's bigoted to say that, particularly when the United Kingdom has managed migration for the other 180-odd countries in the world. And you have to go, their jobs open to talents, let alone the fact that if you have given the post-imperial era and the Commonwealth, it's very hard for English families of Indian or Pakistani of descent to somehow get grandma or granddad over. It's hard for people, if they want to come from Kenya sometimes, to get that job, or Canada or America. But we're part of the Club of Nations, and quite rightly so, one of the four pillars is free movement of people. There's not an issue. So there has been tension there as well. I wonder to what extent this is going to lead to a redundant UKIP. I think it could quite possibly do. UKIP are imploding, they have no MPs, their MPs are now independents, they have no MPs. By Farage stepping down is probably the worst thing that could happen to them, I think. And a weakened SNP. A weakened SNP, Matt? No, they're about to have a second referendum. Yes, and they will lose it. YouTube, you hear it now. This is a prediction. They will lose it. I've broken the fourth wall. I've stared into the camera. And the reason I think they'll lose it is because the Scots don't want it. They have spoken once in a generation a couple of years ago. This is plain, old-fashioned politicking, and Nicola Sturgeon and the SNP are perfectly within their rights to do it. But that's what it is. As I said to CNBC Asia a few weeks ago, this is the SNP using Brexit as a springboard to put pressure on the Westminster government to get a second referendum. Why? Because they're nationalists. They just want to break up the UK. They're not really worried about X, Y, and Z. They want their main goal. They want to break up the UK. And I just think the Scots people will say, no thanks. We've had a conversation about that. we decided not to. We don't want to do it, and we don't want to do it now. If we do it now, we'll be outside the EU, we'll be outside NATO, and the biggest factor, and I think that's what won the day then, the tax take in Scotland's not large enough to provide Scotland with a welfare state, public pensions, public education, free higher education, free personal care for the elderly, free public transport, and free museums. That's not a bad gig. Not a bad gig. The Scots are canny, as is Mr. Marr. They won't vote for that. And my colleague and my friend, academic at Ulster University, Professor Arthur Ockey, wrote, when he came to Hull and he gave the Norton Lecture a number of years ago, wrote an article based upon it when he talked about English nationalism as a mood, not a movement. I wonder whether it's a mood coalescing towards a movement. We have Scottish nationalism, we have Welsh nationalism, we, of course, we know we have Irish nationalism, but I wonder whether English nationalism is being more coordinated. It's a mood now perhaps coalescing towards a movement. A sense actually that there's a lot of folk in England whose voice is not being heard, and this was one of the key ways to express it. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'll take your questions.